Thanks, Graeme, for that very kind introduction. I thought I'd just quickly start off. This is kind of a new area for a lot of people, so I thought I'd just start off with telling you a little bit about what I do and how we might be able to help you. So this is me, kind of a bit of a younger, thinner version of me. I've done lots of, Graeme's given pretty good information about what I've been doing over the years, and also like trout fishing too. But I have to go to the state to do that now. So anyway, and my fellow director in the business, Maria, has done lots of work in particularly the research and looking at how microbes can be applied to mostly farming systems, but a lot of this will apply to different types of soil as well. So our main role is to provide high quality microbiology tests using the best methods that we can find that are, and this is important, that are useful and improve outcomes for our customers. So we're really about the practical side of things. So we try to take, you know, research science and apply it in a practical way, a bit of an extension of research science, if you like. You know, we're mostly involved in agriculture, but a lot of this would relate to agriculture as well, revegetating, you know, degraded farmlands, and, you know, anything we can do to help natural ecosystems is you know, going to have great flow-on benefits to the whole of society, basically. So we try to give you information to make better soil management decisions, is what it's about, and particularly involving soil microbiology. So we're quite focused on outcomes. We try to keep up with the latest techniques if they're useful and practical in a sort of a commercial sense. And we have quite an extensive range, and we're continually improving things to try to make it better. So if you think we can help you with anything like that, please come and talk to me later. So, all right, just a brief introduction. Now on to the real meat of the day. A bit of a really quick fly through about soil microbiology and how that might relate to native grasses and more general in revegetating or improving the ecosystems of native bushlands and grasslands. So what is microbiology? Really, a lot of people are get confused about it, but it's really simply, it's just organisms that are too small to see with the naked eye. And we've got different types. We've got sort of the more complex ones up here, the more simpler types up here, bacteria, single-celled organisms, increasing in complexity till we've got things, you know, fungi, and then we've got protozoa, which are, this guy here is a protozoa, and they're really, like, the reason why I put this video here is to just to demonstrate that these things are alive, and they're quite complex. Some of them, like these protozoa, are really like little animals. They've got kind of little organs inside, and they're doing things. This one's feeding on some bacteria probably there. They tend to eat a lot of bacteria. And then we've got things like nematodes and so forth. Okay, so where are these? Where is this microbiology? Well, it's everywhere, but it's most prevalent in the rhizosphere. And for the non-scientists here, I might use a few technical terms. Don't worry too much about them. It's not important to remember them. What is important, just to get the general overview, and rhizosphere is just another name for root zone, basically. So where the soil microbes live is most concentrated in this zone, around about 2 to 5 millimetres around an actively growing root. So there can be, you know, maybe 100 times more soil microbiology in this area here than there is in the bulk soil. So this is where it's really all happening when talking about soil microbiology. And of course, there are different types, and if you can imagine in this diagram here, if you can imagine this is a plant root, what tends to happen over time is zones of nutrient depletion develop around plant roots as they take in all the nutrients around them, particularly with the less mobile nutrients like phosphorus and zinc and so forth. And so we have types of microbes that, for example, mycorrhizal fungi that can form a symbiosis with the plants. They live inside the root and they can grow out, extend beyond these zones of nutrient depletion and get nutrients from places in the soil where roots can't get to or haven't gotten to, and in forms that plants can't readily take up. So microbes do a number of things. And how does this all happen? Well, you know, all of this, basically soil microbiology is largely driven by food and that the types of food that they eat, and that's mainly carbon, types of carbon, and a lot of it comes from plant roots. So plant roots are leaking out, exuding carbon, and there's dead cells coming off of plant roots. And all those form a type of food for microbes. And so some of those molecules that are given off, those carbon molecules, are small. Things like sugars and amino acids. And they're quite easily able to pass through the membranes, the cell walls, if you like, of microbes, and they can quite easily absorb those and use them for food to grow. But there are other molecules, if you think of this being sort of some sort of plant residue, other molecules are large, things like cellulose and lignin, the things that make, you know, grasses and woody plants tough and woody. They're quite large, and they can't easily pass through that membrane. They're too big, and so they need some further processing and microbial breakdown before the microbes can use those as a source of food. And so if we think about a typical plant residue here, this might be a grass or something rather like that, you can see that it's made up of quite a number of different compounds. For example, we've got some sugars and amino acids and proteins, and then we've got a lot of cellulose, hemicellulose and lignin making up the bulk of it. And in general, if you look at the types of microbes that break these types of compounds down, we've got bacteria that are able to easily eat sugars and amino acids and proteins because they're smaller and they can quite easily take them up. But these larger molecules like cellulose and lignin, those kind of tough woody things, are mainly decomposed by fungi because by and large, they're the organisms that possess enzymes, the enzymes capable of breaking down those molecules and turning them into sugars, which they then eat. So with soil microbiology, nothing's ever black and white, but in general, it's fungi possess those enzymes, and bacteria largely don't, although there's some overlap there, as I say, it's kind of a grey area. And so if we compare that to how fast and slow these things break down, you'll see that the smaller molecules and the things that bacteria are more easily able to get, complete and get for, disappear and are broken down relatively quickly. And these other things like cellulose and lignin and so forth that require enzyme activity by fungi largely tend to break down a lot more slowly. And so that really forms a bit of a basis for what I'm going to say about how the microbial community differs in the soil and what makes it different. But what can microbiology do? Well, for example, in agriculture, we say that we tend to get more consistent results. And I think this is generally applicable across, you know, a wide range of circumstances, including revegetation. So we end up with sort of not so much good versus bad seasons and results. Things tend to even out more. And they can do that by improving things like soil structure, increasing the percentage of water-stable aggregates in the soil, solubilizing nutrients, for example, types of microbes called pseudomonas. Anybody heard of pseudomonas or any of these? Okay, a few, that's good. And they, of course, cycle nutrients. There's a nitrogen cycle, and they can also move nutrients through the soil from places where they are available into the plant root system, and they can also suppress disease. So from what we've heard earlier today in Andrew's and Monique's talk just now, all that you can maybe get an idea of how these things start to relate to the establishment and survival of these different types of plants. So a very quick tour of the basics of microbiology. There's different types. Bacteria, everybody would have heard of. They're single-celled. They have different life strategies. What do I mean by that? I just mean that they like to live in different environments, eat different foods, and they perform different functions. So it's not like there's a bacteria and and there's just one type and that's all they do. There are a lot of different types. And I like to think of it as a bit like being in a hotel at a resort or something or other, and you've got just like at any hotel, you've got all sorts of different guests staying at the hotel. You've got these guys down here by the pool. There's a relaxing, have a little drink with a little one here. And you've got these guys up here, they're what we might call, these guys are might be the party animals, we might call them, and these guys might be the quiet achievers, if you like. Their idea is of a good time is, you know, relaxing in the room, reading a book, you know, taking things a bit quieter. And then we've got fungi up here on the roof, they're doing something completely different altogether. And for example, these bacteria like to occupy different places in the root zone. And, again, don't worry about any sort of scientific terms there, and remembering those. What I want to get across to you is that there are, you know, different types. There are these the types we might call the party animals, or in science called R strategists. These tend to be gram-negative bacteria, which just means that they have a certain type of cell wall, and that indicates that they perform a different type of function. These guys tend to thrive in places with high nutrient availability. For example, around the hairs of root zones, and they prefer good conditions. So just going off, for example, Monique's comments before, if you're thinking about lands where you know, you might have farmlands that might have high nutrient availability in the soil, we might have, for example, in arable zones, we might have a lot of moisture. This is going to influence what types of microbes are going to be around. So on the other hand, we've got these what are called K strategists, or these are the quiet achievers. These tend to be gram-positive, different type of cell wall, doing different things in the soil. And these tend to be things like, for example, actinomycetes. Anybody heard of actinomycetes? Yeah. Things like, good, great. Things like streptomyces. And these tend to gain hold in places with lower nutrient availability. So again, thinking about the types of lands and soils and plants that you've got and where they like to grow, you can see that this is probably going to have some influence on the community of microbes around the soil. And these tend to be able to tolerate adverse conditions better, for example, the drought. And so this makeup, this guest list in the hotel, if you like, around the root zone is influenced a lot by what food's available, a bit like us. What energy source, so are there simple versus these complex types of carbohydrates? And it was interesting to mention before, hear mentioned before about the addition of sugar and sawdust to the Shane Monique's experiments, and it sounds like somebody else has been playing with that as well. So sugar, we've got a simple carbohydrate, and sawdust, we've got what from wood, a lot of lignin and so forth. And so that's going to be you know, providing food source for, you know, kind of two ends of the spectrum there. The sugar bacteria and the wood dust, lignin, encouraging fungal growth. So that's quite a good idea. And other molecules as well. If there are any sort of, too much nitrogen, methane in the soil, chemicals, etc. And then the environment, of course, the pH of the soil, the moisture holding capacity, the minimal nutrient availability, and also the microbial interactions. These microbes kind of live in a community and they communicate with one another, and sometimes that can be synergistic, that is, they help each other to grow. And sometimes it can be an antagonistic, they fight against each other. And that can be good and bad. Synergistic, an example might be, say, for example, mycorrhizal fungi and what's called mycorrhizal helper bacteria, and they tend to live and encourage each other. And an antagonistic example might be, for example, something like a trichoderma type of fungi that's able to suppress other types of fungi around it. And just quite fortunately, often they tend to be the most, like the pathogenic types, so that's very handy. And then, of course, we've got interactions between plants and microbes. This is a busy little diagram here, but I included it just to give you an illustration about plant-microbe interactions. And if I can just, you know, briefly talk through it. For example, we've got a soil bacterium here, which is turns out to be a bit of a plant pathogen. And when it infects the plant, that in turn causes the plant to produce some malic acid, and that malic acid in turn stimulates the growth, or is it a particular food source for a certain type of gram-positive bacteria? And those gram-positive bacteria are able to produce compounds that are then able to suppress other microorganisms in the soil and any other pathogens that might be there. So that's just an example of how this works. It's not straightforward. It's often like a lot of ecosystem functions, and probably a lot of you will understand it. There's often a few interactions involved, but hopefully this will help to at least get you thinking along those lines. Just to put a visual on it, this is Pseudomonas fluorescens, a well-known phosphorus solubilizing microbe. What a cute little fellow, and all these things coming out the back are what are called flagella. They're like little outboard motors, if you like, and they spin around and enable the microbe to move around through the soil, particularly where there's soil moisture, and move about. And this is a micrograph of some actinomycetes, or actinobacteria, as they're often called now. And they look a bit like instant noodles altogether. And has anybody smelt that sort of rain smell when after the soil's been dry, you get that smell? That's usually a compound produced by these guys called geosmin. I don't know who came up with that name, and not very sort of palatable name, but when you smell that smell, think of actinomycetes. They're probably the ones that are responsible for it. And of course, we've got nutrient cycles. We've got the soil bacterial nitrogen cycle, where we've got nitrogen being fixed either into legumes or either by free living nitrogen fixing bacteria, which can live around the roots of grasses. And for example, in agriculture, in wheat and sugarcane, etc., there's a lot of biotechnology gone into making inocula for these nitrogen fixing bacteria that can enable fertilizer reduction. And so then we've got the transformation of those various types of nitrogen from organic form produced by microbes to ammonium to nitrate, and you know that can come by fixation or by breakdown of manures or organic matter, and then uptake into the plants as nitrates, and also somewhat by ammonium as well. And we've also got some denitrifying bacteria that when there are anaerobic conditions occurring in the soil, if the soil is compacted or waterlogged, these guys can proliferate and end up getting rid of that nitrogen. And in agriculture, we tend to think that's a bad thing, but having seen a little bit of what's been presented today, that might not be such a bad thing. In fact, in lettuce production in Arizona, in the US, they actually use this technique well, flooding the fields to actually get rid of excess nitrate that builds up in the soil. So I'm not sure if that's going to be a practical thing, but you can start to see, if you know a little bit about these microbes, you can start to work out ways how they might be managed. I've got a bit of a bell there, so I've only got about 10 minutes left, so we'll keep going and on these. Just a little bit about fungi. There are also lots of different types of fungi, like bacteria. There's single-celled fungi like yeasts, there's multi-celled fungi like molds, and the filamentous fungi, they're the ones you often see with the white hyphae. If you turn over some leaf, decaying leaf mulch or something that has white fibers, they're the filamentous fungi, and they're very diverse. Like bacteria, they have different life strategies, and they prefer different foods, and they perform different functions. Just to look at some yeast, probably everybody's familiar with those. Molds, by eye, they look like that under the microscope. They're quite intricate and complex. But just to mention these, for example, the growth of these guys is limited in more drier conditions, usually, because they have to grow to find their food source. Whereas by comparison, for example, filamentous fungi can remain active in dry conditions, and these can actually grow to find their food source. So there's a little bit of a difference as well. Just thought about that. Imagine we've got a soil a particle here. We've got maybe some clay, some silt, some sand. Imagine if this is there's a lot of moisture in here coating all these films. We've got a food source here, this yellow diagram, and this little purple starting point, we've got a filamentous fungi. If the soil is fairly moist, are you able to tell me who would be able to get to that food source first? Any ideas? Thinking back to our Pseudomonas with its outboard motor, the bacteria probably going to be able to get to that food source first because they can actually move through through soil moisture and moisture films to be able to get that food source. But imagine if the soil was dry now, but a reverse condition was true, who do you think would be able to get to that food first? Fungi? Exactly, that's right. This guy would be like a tinny up on the beach, spinning its outboard motor, not going anywhere. The filamentous fungi can actually grow and extend out to find that food source. So that's just an indication of how environmental conditions can affect microbes. So we've got different types of fungi, and as I mentioned before, they can produce enzymes, and these enzymes release sugars, which are then eaten by the fungi for food. And so there's not a strict niche differentiation. I mean, bacteria love sugar, fungi love sugar. It's just that fungi can have the means of breaking down complex matter to make sugar to get it. So I'll move along quickly now, because I know we're running a little short on time. I'm running short on time. So one of the things I wanted to mention, get to, was these, there's different types. We've got our decomposer type fungi, which we're all familiar with, and then we've got our symbiotic fungi. And a prime example of this is these arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi, which a lot of people still call VAM. It's strictly not the right name, but it's a catchy name and it sticks, and a lot of people know it. So I'm going to stick with it and refer to them as VAM as well. So these are, I think a lot of people would have heard of these. We were talking about it yesterday as well, a little bit, I believe. So these fungi have to live in association with plants. They can't live out by themselves, and they receive sugar from the plants, and at the same time they provide mineral nutrients to the plants. And they, for example, they can produce proteins like glomalin that helps to glue soil together, and they're usually beneficial to plant nutrition and growth. And this is just a micrograph in a root. This is a grass root, and you can see these kind of fuzzy things here are the mycorrhizal structures called arbuscules. That's where they get their name. And this is where the nutrient transfer between the fungus and the plant is thought to take place. And these kind of lines here are the hyphae inside the cells. And this is what's called this is the V for vesicle in VAM. This is kind of a storage sac where excess lipids that the fungus makes are stored for use later on in tough times. So just a diagram illustrating the interaction with these VAM with the other microbes in the rhizosphere. Imagine here a plant root. On the left here we've got a plant root zone that doesn't have mycorrhizas in it. You can see there's a few microbes there around different types. And then if we look at on the right here, a part of the root zone where mycorrhizas have colonized the plant and are growing out, you can see there's a great proliferation of bacteria. And so if we come back to what these microbes can do, they can improve soil structure, influence the plant community, improve drought tolerance, important for establishing things, increase nutrient availability, suppress disease. And very quickly, I'll skip over these things now, I'm out of time, but mycorrhizas, for example, are a key soil organism in soil microbial ecology, because they do so many things. And when you're looking to re-establish plants, particularly in, for example, if you're revegetating a mine site or disturbed soils where there's not enough soil structure, it's been found that clients of ours who are kind of environmental consultants, interstate mine sites, have found that you have to have soil aggregation to effectively establish a plant community back in there. And that, by and large, that's due to micro aggregation of the soil. And you can see there's lots of things in there, and mycorrhizal fungi play a key role in that. Part of the reason is that they produce glomalin, and they also interact with different plants. So mycorrhizas can join, can join two different root systems of plants, and they can aggregate soil And so that also has an influence on the plant community composition as well. This is my old PhD supervisor, Sally Smith. This is a cover of her front book, and I hope she doesn't mind me using it. This is actually a pine seedling, probably in this native vegetation pine. But why I put it there was to show you, so you can kind of see the root system here, and you can see all this kind of furry stuff growing out. This is the micro, this is a different type of mycorrhizae with pines, but the concept is the same. And they grow out and they form this a kind of a very efficient extension of mycorrhizas to the plant root system. Very quickly, again, not grasses, but these could be weeds. And Andrew's comment before, I heard 95% of the work is about dealing with weeds in revegetation. So we've got non-mycorrhizal plants up the top here, and looking at competition between different types of plants. So we've got this. We've got some lamb's tongue here, which could well be a weed out here, and then we've got some hawkweed here, and non-mycorrhizal, this is how they grow, and this is how they interact. And when there's mycorrhizas in there, you can see that we have a different interaction between the two. So hawkweed growing quite well here, lamb's tongue growing quite well, and when you put them together, the lamb's tongue suppresses the hawkweed. So very difficult to find specific examples for Australian native grasses, but you get the idea that these things are having an interaction and affecting what plant species are going to outcompete others. And if we can work that out for in our native situations, we may have a really good key to managing it. Very quickly, drought. Mycorrhizas bring water in through their hyphae into the plant root zone, and they also help inside the plant make the plant more efficient. So keeping on with that, we've got, I'll very quickly just skip to the end, and some summary points, I think I'm well out of time, but we've got tests that can measure all this stuff which are available, so if that's of interest to you, you think can help, please get in touch and let us know. And one of the things I wanted to make was, probably mycorrhizal fungi or VAM are probably the single most important soil microbe in this type of thing when you're looking to revegetate and re-establish things. They're not the most important, but if you were going to say what's the, if you could only choose one, what would it be? I would choose mycorrhizal fungi because they do so many of these different things. Well, that's about all for me. I'll be around for lunch, so if you want to talk about anything more, please let me know.